Tonight, we're going to be running through the Bible, so I like to make sure you have a Bible on Wednesday nights in case you need to know and you like it this way. On Wednesday night, I teach out of the New King James. It's kind of my favorite version to teach out of, so if you want to go get a version or follow along, you can do that with me. I like teaching out of it. Usually use a different version on Sunday morning, so that's the version we'll stick with during this teaching and this semester called Who is the Holy Spirit? You have a worksheet in front of you. Tonight's lesson is called Defining God. As we look into learning about the Holy Spirit, it's kind of a futile thing to try to understand the Holy Spirit without an understanding of who God is. So let's just jump right in. Let's look at the points to ponder, and then we'll run through our points to ponder and get into our teaching. So here's some things I want to say to stretch your brain. Many people are misinformed about the Holy Spirit for this reason. It's just a lack of knowledge. It's never been taught about. I bumped into a guy that had been in church most of his life, and he said, now watch, this was amazing to me. He said, of all my years going to church, I never heard one sermon about the Holy Spirit. Now, I'm not, you know, saying that's necessarily a bad thing, but I am saying in the sense of we have to be careful to make sure that when we teach and we study that we balance the Word of God out, because the Holy Spirit is just as much God as Jesus is God and as the Father is God. And a lot of times it's this lack of knowledge about the Holy Spirit because we've just never been taught about the Holy Spirit, primarily because it is kind of difficult to preach about the Holy Spirit when it's the word Spirit attached to it. At least with God being a Father, we can get images about a Father. And with Jesus being the flesh and a human, we can see images of Jesus painted on a Sistine Chapel or whatnot. But when it comes to the Holy Spirit, because of the word Spirit, or in an older King James, Holy Ghost, it kind of gives it a, you know, this ethereal, misty, cloud, you know, glory, all these words that are kind of hard to define. Can you touch the Holy Spirit? Does he have a form, or does he just float in? Most places he shows up as a wind. So it's kind of hard to even teach it, because how do you really define the wind? Even Jesus says this, the Holy Spirit is like the wind, and you don't know where he comes from or where he's going, but you can sure see the effects, right? Now, here's something to ponder. I think one of the reasons we're so misinformed is because many times the effects of the Holy Spirit scare people. We just get scared. Because when the Holy Spirit begins to move upon a human flesh, we all respond differently. Some people, when the Holy Spirit moves, they cry. Some people, when the Holy Spirit moves, they shout. Some people, when the Holy Spirit moves, they do the Pentecostal, they jerk. There was a guy in my church years ago that every time he, quote, felt the Holy Spirit move, he would chicken dance across the front of the church. He would run this way, he would run this way, and every time he got excited, he would high-five me. He would literally run up to the stage and high-five me. I thought it was an interesting thing because what we have to ask ourselves about this misinformed Holy Spirit, how do we really know it is or is not the Holy Spirit? Because connected to the Holy Spirit is subjectivity. Because in any church service, someone could say this, well, I felt the Holy Spirit. And somebody else could say, well, I didn't feel a thing. Oh, man, that sermon just touched me. Woo, wasn't that anointed? And somebody else say, well, I was just bored. I didn't get anything out of it. You can hear a song played on the stage and your hair stand up on the back of your neck, and that hair standing up is deemed to be the Holy Spirit. And we say things like, ooh, did you feel that? Did you sense His presence? Did you feel the anointing? And anytime we use those words, sense, feel, did you pick that up? It can be very subjective to what is truly the Holy Spirit versus just what are our emotions. And because of that, because the Holy Spirit is so subjective at times to our emotional responses, many times the Holy Spirit activity scares people off. They just get scared of the Holy Spirit. Oh, I don't want to do that. I was in a service one time. Those people went nuts. I don't want to do that. I'm not about to lay on a floor like a tadpole flopping on a floor out of water. I'm not doing that. I'm not going to say those funny words, shoot a pecan down, who stole my Honda Tama, but I'm not doing that. That's strange. So this Holy Spirit thing almost becomes an enigma in the teaching of Christianity. It almost just becomes this hard to define. So rather than really digging it out, many times it's just easier to ignore it. Let's just talk about all the other stuff in the Bible. Let's just focus on Jesus and focus on the Father. And let's just kind of skip over all of these chapters that introduce us to the Holy Spirit. The second thing we need to ponder is this. Unknown realms can lead to fearful expectations. Unknown realms can lead to fearful expectations. When the Holy Spirit is unknown to you, it's easy for your head to be fearful. I get nervous when the Holy Spirit moves. I don't know if I want to go up to that altar because I don't know what might happen to me there. So it's easy to just push the experience away because of what we've seen on TV, because now what we have in 2016, we didn't really have in the 60s and 70s, is we have YouTube. So now we can see all the crazy antics that Christians do who say they're spirit-filled. We can see all the crazy things. And that crazy things can be gold dust and feathers falling out of the sky and all the crazy things we see. So there's a whole group of people over here going, woo, gold dust fell from the ceiling. Gold dust was all over me. My palms were sweating gold. It was God. And then there's a whole group of people up here going, honey, gold on your hands is not God. Right? Both of them you got to be kidding me. Feathers falling from the ceiling just means there's probably birds in your attic. It doesn't mean the Holy Ghost is here. And so even the definition of the Holy Spirit is difficult to know, because when he does show up, he shows up as a bird, a dove. So, you know, when you think of God the Father, it's always an old guy with a big long beard or a big just bright light. That's God the Father. When you think of Jesus, it's this really nice guy with a great body and a beautiful beard and bronze skin on a nice flowing white robe, and he's either got a little baby in his hand or he's standing on the water and he's bidding you to come to him, and that's easy to get. And then you get to the third person of the Godhead, the Holy Spirit, and it's a bird. It's like a bird? So it's kind of just easy to push that side of the Godhead away because it's a bird. And then it's connected to a flame of fire, a tongue. And so all these things of the Holy Spirit, wind, bird, fire, they can make us be fearful when we've not been taught well. The third point to ponder is this. It leads us to a question: can the Holy Spirit be known? Can he, this wind, bird, all of these glory, the anointing, the cloud, the feelings, can we really know it? Now, when I say the word know, I don't mean subjectively. I mean objectively. Do you know the difference between subjective and object? Subjective is, ooh, I feel this. Objective is, I present facts. So the question is, can we know the Holy Spirit objectively as well as subjectively? Can I know him? My answer to this, if you want to put out there, is a big fat yes. And this is what we're going to dig out this semester. You can objectively know this person of the Godhead called the Holy Spirit. So let's jump into it. Genesis chapter 1. I want to start out with teaching about the Holy Spirit by going back to the book of Genesis. I try to do this with every subject I teach. I believe the foundation of all truth starts in the book of Genesis. So to understand God, to understand if the Holy Spirit is God, that was our question, can he be known? So what I would need to ask myself first, is the Holy Spirit God? And if the Holy Spirit is God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, if he is God... So we have a Father here, we have a Son here, and we have the Holy Spirit here. And in the center of these, they're all God. But they're interconnected with one another so that the way that it would go, God is a Father, but God is not the Son. The Son is not the Father. The Son is not the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's not the Father. The Father's not the Holy Spirit, but they're all God. We're going to kind of dig this out in a little bit, but I just want you to get a picture of what we're going to talk about. When we say God, and we use the term God in our prayers, dear God, I pray that you, a lot of times we do just think of one entity. God is one. He is one, but we really have to look at this issue that in Christian doctrine that is called the Trinity. It's three in one, but it is one. God is one, but there's three aspects of God, and there's three in one of God, so that when we say God, now watch, this is very important as we start digging this out. When we refer to God, though many times we may be just thinking this, or just God not really dichotomized, not dichotomized, but God in three essence of a Father, a Son, and a Holy Spirit. But when you say the term God, you cannot dichotomize them out from one another. They are in and of themselves one. The Father's not the Son, who's not the Holy Spirit, who's not the Father, but all three are God. So keep this in your mind, because we're gonna run the way to come back to this to show you how this Holy Spirit fits in this equation. All right, so let's look at it from Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. And listen to it. We get four words into it, and this is what we say. We're going to read verse 1, verse 2, and verse 3 together. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering above the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light." In the beginning, God, the Spirit of God was hovering, and then God said, "Let there be light." Three verses into it, we find that God has a voice, God is light, there is a Spirit, and there is a beginning. We don't even get into the Bible to discuss much, and the Spirit shows up by verse 2, right? So the Spirit has shown up by verse 2. So in my opinion, if you introduce the Holy Spirit by verse 2, of the Bible, it would say to me, he is going to play a critical part of the entire story. If he's been introduced as one of the main characters in verse 2. Come on, you playwrights. I'm introducing my main characters in the very first verses of the Bible. Although, here's what we can say about this God in the beginning, God. In the beginning, God. Now here's what I would like to say about the beginning in theory, though it doesn't teach me this yet, but it will play itself out. Here's one of the first persons of the Godhead that's introduced. In the beginning, God and the Spirit of God was hovering. So let's don't run all the way through the New Testament. Just verse 1 and 2, I mean, I am a pretty critical essence to the story when I'm introduced first. And then it says, and God said, which we will find out through the New Testament, that the Word becomes flesh, and that flesh is Jesus. So by verse 3, we've got an intro to the Son. As we move through the New Testament, we find out that the Son was involved the whole time, even before the foundations of it all. Now watch this, how interesting this gets. In the beginning, God. Now what that's going to tell me is this. There is a beginning point, and if there's a beginning, there's naturally a what? Naturally an end. Now logically, here's what it tells me about this beginning point of God. If God is in the beginning, that tells me for Him to be in the beginning here when it starts, it tells me that He must have existed before the beginning for Him to be there at the beginning, right? For Him to be at the beginning, it would logically assume that He was before the beginning, which would lend itself that He's always been there, which is hard to tell an 8-year-old because they're going to ask, when was His birthday, when was He born, and who was His parents? But God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, were in the beginning before the beginning ever was. They were there. We define this as the eternal. The eternal is the realm of God. It's the realm within which God was before He ever struck the realm that you and I call time, where He started measuring these 24-hour days and He begins to push Himself through time. So what we're going to find out about God is this. If God was in the beginning, He must have been before the beginning. All right? He was in the beginning, must have been before. If He was before it ever started, that means He must be in a realm outside of time. This is going to play a huge role of understanding this Holy Spirit. He is in a realm that's outside of time. If we drew it in an object lesson and we put this frame in which we humans live in, this box that we call time, we even say this about Christianity. If you want to live how long? Forever. Eternal life. You must get Jesus so that when it ends, if you have Jesus, you hit this realm called the eternal and you live forever. But right now, inside this box, we all know that there's a birthday and there's your funeral day. We're all headed there, as gruesome as that sounds, unless He comes back and raptures me out of here and takes me into a place outside of time like we would know it, like we would measure it. It's 24-hour period. But He stuck me inside this. Now, here's what's interesting about this. Inside our thing we call time, there is the present time, which is right where you are right now. There is the past, which is anything a second ago. You already have lived your past. It started 15 minutes ago when we started. And then this is not really that deep of a teaching, but there is the future. Now, the strange thing about you inside this is you are bound that you never get to get into the future. Because every time you get into the future, it's now your present. So that even though we say, well, it's 7:37 right now, the future of 7:37 is 7:39, but we're not in 7:39. But when we get to 7:39, the future became our present. So the binding to this is you and I do not have the human capability to go into the future. Now, we can try to go into the future, tarot card reading, Ouija boards, crystal balls, all the things that humans try to do to see into the future. But God has bound us to not know the future, except something really strange is going to happen with this, with the Holy Spirit. So here we are, bound to present and bound to past, and we can't really know the future, but it's coming, and we'll never get into the future because when it gets here, we're already there. Now here's the beautiful thing. If you sit outside of this time, you're on the outside of it, right? Watching it all, overseeing it all as God, a Father, Son, and a Holy Spirit. You're overseeing it all. Watch how interesting this is. At any given point along the way that we call past, present, or future, to the one who's outside of it, it's never past, present, and future. It's always right now. It's always now. It's how God can be both in the past, both right now, and both into the future, because he sees all. And he equally can be anywhere at any given time, at any moment, because he's above time, watching it play out as an eternal God. Does that make sense? So that for him, who's seeing the whole thing, as he's watching it, my past is his now, my present is his now, and my future is his now. And he can see from the beginning of time to the end of time, and therefore know everything that's going to happen in that, because he's God and he sits outside of it, and neither is he bound to it. What's interesting is when he puts himself in it, he inserts himself into the Son inside of this equation. It's when it really gets interesting. And the beauty of this God is that he didn't put me in this box of time and say, well, good luck, right? Just good luck. I hope you make it. I'll be out here waiting on you. What he did do is when he put me in this box called time, is that God shot a prophetic word all the way to the end, so that my past, present, and future is connected to his prophetic promises. So that anywhere along the spectrum of my past, present, and future, if I but hold on to his word, that his word will forever change my past, my present, and my future, because it is running through my time frame. So that when he prophesies to Eve that the seed of woman will crush the head of the serpent, when God says it to Eve, even though it's 4,000 years into the future, he says it as if it has already happened. Because for him, he's out here seeing that it's going to happen right here, but when he speaks it here, it's already now. So when he says to Abraham, here, you shall have a child as numerous as the stars of the sky, but the kid is not going to be born to here, 25 years removed. When God speaks it to him here, though it's 25 years here, God speaks it as if it's already done, because to God, 25 years is now. All I need you to do is just trust me with it, right? So God operates both inside and outside of time, which is profound. It blows your mind, because what it tells me about the nature of God, remember, we're trying to define God so we can really pull this out. Because if I can define the nature of God, that nature will play itself out in a Father, Son, and a Holy Spirit. Now watch this beauty of God, who is above time, who is outside of time, but who bound himself into time, put me into time, and said, fear not, for when I speak and I give the command and the word, even though it's 4,000 years removed, you can stake your life on it. You can put your life on it, that in this past, present, and future of you, when you hold on to the word of God, faith comes by hearing, and faith is now, right? I've had people say, well, Mark, I don't understand. I'm believing and you're telling me I'm already healed, but I don't feel healed. I still feel sick. Well, do you believe the word? Well, I believe he himself took my infirmities and bore my sicknesses, and by his stripes I'm healed. Then you're healed. Well, I don't feel healed. I still have a fever. Why do I still have it? See, what we're literally saying is this, is that when we lay hands on you here and we release the word of healing, you're already healed, even though the healing may not manifest to 2 years later. And therefore, you live healed, act healed, talk healed, walk healed, jump healed, sing healed. You quit whining, you quit bickering, you quit complaining, because I got healed here when they touched me with the word of God. Well, you hadn't seen it yet. I don't have to see it. He promised it, and if he promised it, it's already now. All you have to do is hold on to the now until the now becomes now. And that's the hard part of faith. Can you hold on now until now becomes now? And walk it out. Because this journey from God's now, which is my present, to His now, which is my future. Oh, man. The emotions. The questions. Well, if He heals, why am I not healed? Because you can't base it on time. You have to base it on promise. Come on. You can't base it on time. You base it on promise. If God promised it, He cannot lie. And if He cannot lie, it's just as certain to me today as it will be when it manifests. In other words, the reality of God, is it certain now because He promised it, not certain when I feel it. So it's certain. And when it's certain, before it's certain, you're at rest. Right? I'll say that again. When it's certain, before it's certain, you're at rest. Everybody else may be falling apart, but you're good. How can you be good? Because He's already in my now. He's in my future, and my future is His now, and He's already promised me I'd be healed. I'm good. All right? So that is one of the things I have to see. Now, watch. Hence, our past, present, and future is all God's now. That's why He can't lie. He already knows what's ahead. This is what's so interesting about this equation. Inside time. Here's what's so valuably important in this box. When your present and your future have a 25-year gap, but He promised it here, but the baby's not born till here, when is God a truth teller? Yeah, when He said it. Humans think He's a truth teller when she's pushing the baby out. Woo, you got it, sister. No, I got it back here. You just saw it here, right? So I got it back here. You saw it here. Now watch this. This journey, and this is where I think we mess up with this God thing, this journey, often we want to see the miracle, but it's not a miracle, it's a process. It's a process of faith. Now watch what's funny. The question would be, is it really a miracle when the baby is born? Or it was the miracle before he was born because I got a promise? If you're looking at the result being proof of the miracle, then your miracles only manifest when you see results. But if you look at His promise as the miracle, you get your miracle before you ever see the baby. Right? You understand what I'm saying there? Now, here is this gap of 25 years, and therefore, because it's an eternal God outside of time who's always now speaking into my present about my future, here's the answer to every human in the room. And it's a hard word. It's the word, trust me. And man, is that not hard as a human sometimes? It's trust me. But God, trust me. Well, I'm trying to. Trust me. Give me some fruit. I did. I gave you my word. Trust me. Right? So this essence of God that plays itself out, here's the truth that we can take from this. Nothing within our scope of knowledge is outside the realm of His possibility. Come on, that's good preaching. Nothing within our scope of knowledge is outside the realm of His possibility. Mark chapter 5, verse 23, I believe it is. It says, Mark chapter 10, verse 23, it says this. All things are possible to him who believes. For it says this, for with God, all things are possible. How could he say that? How could Jesus, the Son, say of the Father, all things are possible? This is why I think because he knew how powerful the eternal is, the eternal realm. I think he knows the power that this eternal realm wields in this present realm that we live in. So it says, look, it's all possible. So now what this is going to tell me as we begin to pull out this Holy Spirit, what it's going to tell me about this is it's going to lend me that once I begin to have a relationship with the Holy Spirit, the possibilities are unlimited. They're unlimited. But I need money. It's unlimited possibility. But I need help. It's unlimited possibility. But I need you. It's unlimited. You can walk on water if you need. We'll multiply loaves and fish if we need. We'll raise dead people if we need. The potential is unlimited. So what this is going to tell me about the Holy Spirit is when the Holy Spirit begins to move upon human flesh, the very moving of it as we play it out is going to be connected to the impossible. This is why on the day of Pentecost, as they begin to speak in a language they did not know, that's impossible. How can I speak a language I don't even know? Because the Godhead has moved you into the realm of possibility. What is impossible is now possible. Number two, back to Genesis chapter 1, verse 3, and God said, let there be light. In the beginning, there was light. Now, here's what's an interesting thing as we try to remember, we're trying to define God, which is kind of a challenge. Here's what we can say first. God was in the beginning. God was eternal. If God is eternal, it's always now. If it's always now, everything is possible. All right. Point number two is that God is light. 1 John, I gave you the scripture there. 1 John verses 1 and 5, God is light, and in Him is no darkness at all. He's light. Now, doesn't that seem hard to define? God is light. Well, I can look at this light right here and go, okay, well, I get a perspective. You even see on TV, oh, I died and I was in a tunnel and I saw a light, right? I saw a bright light. I saw fields full of flowers. Well, some of that, I believe, could be true because God is light. And we often hear near-death experiences. I saw a light and I began to walk toward the bright light. It was so bright I couldn't even see. And then us Christians deduce, well, that was God because God is light. Now, here's what I need you to understand about this God is light, because this is where it gets really, really interesting. Even outside our earthly habitat, this is strange. I think this is why science and the Bible would work hand in hand if people believed it. We measure distance and time by light outside of our earthly realm. Inside of our earthly habitat here called Earth, we measure by our watch and our calendar and by the solar calendar. Sun comes up, sun goes down, it's fall, winter, spring, and summer, and we measure with the sun and the moon. But once you get outside of this earthly habitat, we measure time with light. I gave you something in your, I think it's pretty interesting. I wrote it down. I am not an astronomer, so I stole this. And I did the math for you. Our closest star, so just look at your sheet, I'll read it. One of the closest stars beyond our sun and our galaxy is Proxima Centauri. It is 4.2 light years away. Okay? So when they measure this star, they scientifically measure it at 4.2 light years away. The speed of light is 186,000 miles per second. 186,000 miles per second. If we put that into hours like we're used to, I went 60 miles an hour, it's 669,600,000 miles an hour. 669 million miles an hour is how fast light's going, all right? Now, one of the closest stars we measure is 4.23 light years away. A light year, scientifically, is about 5.8 trillion miles. So our closest star that we can measure scientifically using the light theory is about 4.2 light years away, or around 24 trillion miles away. That's just outside of our realm. Watch this. The space shuttle that you see going around our orbit orbits at 18,000 miles an hour. If that space shuttle at 18,000 miles an hour took off to that closest star, it would take them 156,000 years to reach it. That's how far that distance to the closest star is. Traveling 18,000 miles an hour, it would take a spaceship 156,000 years to get there. That's just mind-blowing. Our finite minds can't even grasp that. And if you ever just want your mind blown, just go to YouTube and Google the vast expanse of our galaxy. It is mind-blowing that this little dot called the Earth becomes the center of all of God's activity. Oh, holy smoke. This little dot in the expanse of the Milky Way and all of the other galaxies become the pinpoint of God's activity for the kingdom. There's something supernaturally special about the Earth. I know most religions worship the sun, but God has supernaturally put the earth. As a matter of fact, just to help all of those other religions, the earth was here before the sun. The sun wasn't even created until around day four. The earth was here before the sun was ever created. That ought to tell you something about how special the earth is. In other words, the earth didn't even need the light of sun and moon because God was light. He just put sun and moon there to govern the night and the day and the seasons. He didn't put the sun there to give the light. He is the light. And so what it tells me about this, and I just gave you that little mathematical equation to just make you understand, 156,000 years at 18,000 miles an hour just to get to one of our closest stars. Here's the truth that it tells me about God when it says God is light. And I believe it's this. The truth is that God can be all places instantaneously. Instantaneously. He's light. You can't outrun Him. Now, this is my opinion, so don't walk out of here and go, he's a nut. Right? This is just an opinion. I believe this is how Jesus could walk through walls when He was resurrected. Because of this immortal, glorified body, I believe it has something to do with the realm of light. He could just walk right through walls. And it not even... I also think this is scientific in time travel. As we try to go into the other dimensions of space and time, I think it's how Philip got translated. I mean, we just kind of read he disappeared. But I think what happened is, just an opinion, I think what happened is there's something about this God being light, and just at the speed of light, He was gone. I think that's how Jesus could be in heaven one minute and here on the earth the next minute. I think that's how they could be in the room talking about Him and He just appears. He's like, hey, fellas, I'm here. My belief, this is just my belief, you don't have to believe it. I don't think it's an eternal thing we need to fight over. But my belief is when we are in eternity, we will not be bound by time and we will be able to do instantaneous travel. We will just be able to be, especially in the millennial kingdom, when we're ruling and reigning as glorified bodies. And let's say I'm in Argentina ruling and reigning as one of God's glorified bodies, the church. I believe instantaneously I can go from Argentina to Jerusalem. Just instantaneous. Because I'm in a glorified body and I have, that's just kind of weird space time travel. But remember, it's no big deal because the person who made space and time is my Father. Now, here's what's funny. Hollywood has no problem believing this. Back to the Future, Back to the Future 2, Back to the Future 3, all of the nice stuff about the future, what's going to happen in the future, and we just eat buttered popcorn all day long. But when you start talking about Christians being able to time travel and disappear and walk through walls, we're like, oh, crazy stuff. Oh, demon stuff there. Stay away from that. You know what I mean? So I'm not going to go there tonight, but I do want you to just kind of think, isn't it comical that Hollywood has no problem believing it, and scientists are trying to figure out how to time warp themselves, but we Christians who serve the God that created it all are blown away and just are stuck at noon and can't even decide where to eat lunch and fall apart emotionally because I'm at a red light. So what does it tell me about the Holy Spirit? Watch. Even though for me, I sometimes feel like God is late. Because He's instant, He's always on time. So what I do want you to get out of this is the Holy Spirit is instant, in season and out of season. This is why Paul would tell Timothy, be instant in season and out of season. In other words, what I think he meant by that is, you need to have a relationship with the Holy Spirit instant to keep you ready in these seasons here. Because there's the past, present, and future. But if you want to be instant in all of that, you better be over here with the instantaneous person of the Godhead. So if you want to be ready for the future, you better know Him. You want to be ready for tomorrow, you need to know Him because He's in your tomorrow. This is why Jesus will say about Him, I think it's John 16. I believe it is. In John 16, He will say of the Holy Spirit, He will show you things to come. In other words, as strange as it may be, you should never again have to read a horoscope, a Ouija board, tarot cards, get your palm read, because the moment you do that, you are denying the person of the Godhead the right to know your future. And you are trying to give some witch or warlock or some tarot card person the ability to read your horoscope and Taurus. My horoscope Taurus says today is going to be a... And people just eat that up. Now, I mean, I'm not one that reads it. I'm not going to condemn you for doing it. But my question as a shepherd is why in the Sam Hill, that's South Georgia, why in the Sam Hill would you put more stock in a horoscope than in the voice of the Holy Spirit who's already in your future and knows everything there is to know and will guide you into truth the whole time? Why? Because He's already there. And what this whole thing about Him being instant, I love this about the Holy Spirit. In any situation, at any time, at any moment, He's instantly there for you. So what this teaches me is I have to learn how to have relationship with Him on an instant. Not just on Sundays, not just during my devotions at night, not just on Wednesday night at BU. Because He is instant, I need to be ready for Him at Walmart. I need to be ready for Him in the grocery store. Why? Because He's instant. In any minute, He could show up and tell me something. So what it does here, this is not on your notes, but what that instant does is it creates in me an expectation so that when a believer lives a boring life, it just tells me that they've lost the expectation of the Holy Spirit showing up instantaneously. My marriage is falling apart. Well, instantly the Holy Spirit could show up. I've had a hellacious day. My day's falling apart. Well, instantly He could show up and bring you peace. So what happens, rather than expecting His instant intervention, we expect our constant frustration. Oh, you need to tweet that or something. Rather than expecting His instant intervention, we begin to expect our constant frustration. Just, now I gotta go to work. I hate going to work. I hate the people I work with. Well, that's because you're living a constant frustration. But when you wake up and you don't even like the people you work with, but you get up anyway because you know when you walk into the room, the Holy Spirit walks into the room. And when I come into the room, I bear the presence of God. And when I come into the room, peace comes into the room with me. And it may be a hellhole, but when I walk in the room, peace follows me everywhere I go. And then my day just starts changing. Then I'm not a jerk all day long because I'm expecting Him to show up any minute. All right, so that's good preaching, but at least I was preaching myself happy there for a minute. Number three. In the beginning, and this is in Genesis 1, verse 26. Remember, we're defining God. In the beginning, let us. Now, we don't even get out of chapter 1 before we come to the understanding that God has defined himself as plural. He's plural. The Trinity is not something we came up with. God said it of himself, us. Now, in Genesis 1, we don't know who the us is then. The us could be 30 of them. But as you read your Bible, the us becomes pretty clear. There's three of them. We really don't know much about a father until Jesus comes. We just know about God. We don't really know about a son at all. We may be expecting it, but we may not. So in the Old Testament, you just read a lot of stuff about God. And if you don't have wisdom, was it God the Son manifesting in the bush of fire, God the Father manifesting in the bush of fire, or God the Holy Spirit manifesting in the bush of fire? We don't really know. We can theologically deduce, maybe hit all of them, but what we do know is that God spoke from the bush. Now, the New Testament by far sheds light on the matter because in the New Testament we see the works of all three. The Holy Spirit moves on Mary to produce a fleshly child called Jesus, who is God in the flesh, who leads us and begins to say things like the will of the Father. When you pray, pray our Father. I can't do anything except the Father tell me to do it. Don't even go do anything until you've been endued with power. So in the New Testament, we start understanding that this us of Genesis 1 is three people, hence where we get our doctrine of the Trinity, Trinity meaning three. It's three people. It's a Father, a Son, and a Holy Spirit. So in the New Testament, you will get a really good glimpse at the different roles, because what happens in the Old Testament, it just seems like God has one role. It's just God. Sometimes he seems mad, sometimes he seems happy. Sometimes he's killing a lot of people and opening up the earth, and sometimes he's saving a lot of people. You just never know. He kind of seems like he's bipolar. Real strange God in the Old Testament. Even when you debate with people about God, they'll always pull up the God of the Old Testament. Well, he's a baby killer. He kills babies. Well, what they don't understand is the God of the Old Testament that just often appears as one in the New Testament appears most often as three. So watch. Whatever I deduce about God here has to always be ran through here to make sense. Right? And I'll tell you how we know that. To dichotomize God, that means to break him up into little pieces, is to weaken the Godhead. For God is three, but you can't separate them. Three in one, but you can't chop them up. Now watch, this is very important for us Christians. If you cannot dichotomize God, because a house divided will fall, you can't divide God. You can't say, well, I'm just going to have Jesus and the Father, but I'm going to leave the Holy Spirit in the back room like a redheaded stepchild. If you claim God, you take all three because you can't chop them up. So the work of the enemy, because Jesus said, which is easy to get Jesus, we have pictures of him. Jesus said, I go to my Father, but it is expedient that I send you another helper who will be with you forever. And when he said that, the devil took notice and said, oh, no, 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 no. Oh, no, 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 no. No, 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 no. No, 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 no. Let's just put a question mark and an exclamation point and keep people really confused here. I don't mind you people down here talking about Jesus. You can talk about Daddy. You can sing songs about Jesus. But I need y'all stupid about the Holy Ghost. Because if I can keep you dumb, you'll never have power. Because if you only focus here and you take this one out of the equation because of your denominational preferences or your theological beliefs, you have dichotomized God and you've played into the warfare of the devil to remove part of the Godhead so he can weaken your life. I'll just throw this out. This is my belief. I'm willing to change and I'm willing to talk about it if you disagree. So you don't have to believe this. You can't even come to Jesus without the help of the Spirit. And you can't even go to the Father without Jesus. So what better way than Satan just to remove this and take it totally out of the church's equation, and we just sit around and sing songs and have great little programs and do all the stuff that we do in the name of Jesus, and we never introduce people to the Holy Spirit. But He's the one that draws me to Jesus. So therefore, you know good and well now why the devil has put a big question mark over the Holy Spirit. Because this is my take of 30 years of, I'm 51, so but 30 years in ministry. I have never met one person, not one. This is the honest truth. Not one. Like I lie, but this is the honest truth. I've never met one person who has had a relationship with the Holy Spirit that did not tell me it turned my life around. Totally changed my life. I met the Holy Spirit my whole life. This is just my opinion. I'm sure Mom, Wilma, those that have been baptized in the Spirit a long time, those that have been baptized in the Holy Spirit will even say things like, my Bible became alive. Like the Word just became alive because of this relationship with the Holy Spirit. To know God, therefore, is to know the Spirit, for the Spirit is God. To know God is to know the Spirit. So you say, well, who is the Spirit? Well, the Spirit's God. So let's just try, this is what we're trying to do, define God. God's light, He's instantaneous, all things are possible, He's in the realm of all possibility. And then, to define God then, is to define the Spirit. This is what we're doing. We're trying to start the night by defining the Spirit, kind of getting an essence of letting you know before we get into all of His characteristic traits, laying out one foundation tonight: He is God. And in the equation of importance, the Spirit is just as important as the Son, who is just as important as the Father, and they all three intertwine and work together to accomplish the will of the Father. All right, working together. Here is number the truth of that. The Spirit is God, just as the Son is God, and just as the Father is God. They're all three God. Now, you can answer this on your paper, but in your own perspective of the three, do you feel like you have equal knowledge of all three facets of the Godhead? Do you understand when somebody says the Father what He is about? And when somebody, now we probably all in the room know a little more about Jesus, and probably statistically less about the Holy Spirit. So most of us Christians focus here. Nothing wrong with that. He's God. He's not jealous. But here is always pushing us to here. I think that's why in our generation we have such an attack on fathers today. The fatherhood, because this is what Jesus is pushing us to, the relationship to the will of the Father. Pray thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Father's will be done. All right? Number four. This is my favorite. Back to Genesis 1:26. Let us make man in our image. So, this is going to sound interesting. I want to stretch your brain place a little bit. God created humans to look like Him in our image. So when you look at me, born again or not, there is an essence to us humans that look like Him. We debated this in seminary. It was a deep debate. But if God said of Himself, let us make you to look like us, then there's something about us that distinctly look like God. So what it's going to tell me about God is He's approachable, He's knowable, He has eyes and ears and feelings and hands and feet because I'm in His image. Now, the beautiful thing about this, are you tracking with me? I want to lose you. We've got a few minutes before we have to end. When God said, let us make man in our image, when He said man, that's my best female. She's ugly. But for every man, there's a woman. So when God said, let us make man in our image, now this is deep. You can study it yourself. I'm not going there tonight. But it tells me that there is an essence of God that's perfectly displayed in both male and female. I think a lot of times that's why there can be such an attack on women in ministry. But I do want to say this about this man and woman relationship. For God to perfectly express Himself, He needed a male and a female to come together to express the image of Him. Now, there's one thing about this that's interesting. And I don't know how people can miss this because it is a brilliant God put within man and woman the ability to do something that no one else can do, and it's that we have the ability to create other humans. In other words, a girl and a guy hook up, a sperm connects to an egg, we're creating humans, baby. That's a God thing. That's why there's an attack on abortion. That's why there's an attack on marriage, because to attack the womb of a woman and to attack the sanctity of marriage is to attack the divinity that we humans have resident within us, that we ourselves, like God, can create other human beings. We create life. That's amazing. Aliens can't create life. Baboons can't create life. A human, we can create other life. I'm not talking about they can't make monkeys life, but the life of another human created like God in His image. What it tells me about this, it is impossible, I-M-P-O-S-S-I-B-L-E, that sounds like a country song. It is impossible to know God outside of relationships. It's just impossible. I won't say impossible, that's a hard word. It's nigh next to impossible. You were designed for relationships. That's why in the body of Christ it's so hard to find people's place, because to grow with God, it takes other believers to grow me. And I don't like that. I just want to go home and read my Bible and grow up. You won't grow up without other people. It's required of us. To mature, I'm going to have to know you. You're going to have to know me. Now watch this. It gets interesting. It would be fair to say that humans display the characteristic traits of God. It's fair to say humans display the characteristic traits of God, and I'm going to go there because of I give you these verses on your worksheet to study later. Because Jesus, who is God, came as a human, and He is the express image of God. Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through about 4, the Bible says that Jesus is the express image of God. So there's something about Jesus, the human, that's the express image of God. So let's end here. So if this is true, that humans display a nature of the Godhead, here's where it gets interesting. I'll end right here. I want to keep you past the time I said I'd let you go, so we're right on an hour. Let's draw it back out again. We've got the Father, we've got the Son, and we've got the Holy Spirit. And they make up God. All right? They make up God. We are in His image. So here's Mark. And Mark has a soul, which is my will. Mark has a flesh, which is my flesh, my body. And Mark has a spirit, which is my breath. 1 Thessalonians 5, Mark is spirit, Mark is soul, and Mark is flesh. All three of those make up Mark. I am not completely marked if any of them are out of the equation. If you get rid of my spirit, my body's gone. If you take away my soul, my will, my ability to make choices and decisions, I can't function. If anybody in here has ever had the flu, you know it affects these two areas, right? The flesh. But all three of these make up me. You cannot take one away from the other. I'm all of them. And if any area is dysfunctional, it affects me. Just like up here, if the Son decides not to do what the Father wants and the Father decides to be the Spirit, there's dysfunction. That's why in a human being, the devil works overtime on your emotions and your will or your flesh so that you cannot function spiritually to do the will of God. He dichotomizes you. You spend 24 hours a day on your flesh and 10 minutes on your spirit. And therefore, you become dysfunctional because you've dichotomized. You don't mind 5 hours in the gym, but you spend 10 minutes a week here. Or you spend 20 hours here, but you're just dumb. You don't make good choices. Your will, your emotions are out of sync with God. You're angry all the time. You're pouting. You're whiny. You're mean. All of these have to function for Mark not to be dysfunctional. This is the express image of this. So what it tells me, I'll end here, is that the Father represents the will, the Son represents the flesh, and the Holy Spirit represents the breath. This is why He breathed on them in John. I am soul, the Father's the soul, the will. I have a will. Everything here is subject to my will. I want to lose weight, it's subject to my will. If I'm going to pray and seek the Spirit, it's subject to my will. Your will is the decision-making factor that's in control of your life. You can will to just sit down and not do anything spiritually. You can ignore God. You can press into God. So that the will is seen here is why Jesus said, I can do nothing except the will of the Father tell me to do it. And I have to have the breath of the Spirit, which would tell me this, you can't do anything without breath. Try to talk without taking in a breath, and before long, every word you speak will end. You have to ultimately go and breathe back in. And to stop breathing is to die. So here's the end result. Man's makeup is spirit, soul, and body. And this is the express image of you. You're a spirit, you're a soul, and a body. And that's the express image of you. And here's the conclusion. The truth of God is that there's a will of heaven called the Father. There's the flesh of heaven called the Son. And this is what we're going to be studying. There's the breath of heaven called the Spirit. And we're going to tackle over the next several weeks learning about the breath. Because the breath is what brings the life. Even Jesus won't let them go out and witness until the breath of heaven has endued them with power. It is a supernatural thing. Stand up. I hope that gave you something to ponder this week.